It's a great pleasure for me to introduce today's distinguished speaker, Professor Lauren Greenlee, from the Ralph E. Martin Department of Chemical Engineering at the University of Arkansas. Professor Greenlee obtained her bachelor's in engineering degree in chemical engineering in 2001 from the University of Michigan, and then spent the next several years working in Europe, in France and Switzerland, before returning to Boston to work for a pharmaceutical startup company. She returned to academia, and instead of doing her PhD in our department, apparently she was about to apply here, or applied, right? You applied, yeah. We don't know if we accepted her, but she moved to the University of Texas at Austin, where she obtained her master's in environmental engineering and her PhD in chemical engineering. She then moved to the National Institute of Standards and Technology in Boulder, Colorado, where she became project leader in 2011 and research group principal investigator in 2015. It was short-lived because you moved to chemical engineering, and she assumed her current position in the Department of Chemical Engineering at the University of Arkansas, where she's the holder of the Lewis Owen Professorship. Professor Greenlee's research group is interested in the development and characterization of nanoparticles and nanostructured materials for water treatment, electrochemical energy conversion, and chemical conversion applications. So please join me in warmly welcoming Professor Lauren Greenlee, who is going to share with us her experience and research work on iron, nickel, bimetallic nanoparticles as an electrocatalyst and a reactive water treatment material. Lauren.
So thank you for that introduction. So as Sakis mentioned, I am going to talk to you today about one of the materials that we work with. So we, in general, are a materials group, and we focus on non-precious metals. And so I'll talk a lot today about our bimetallic iron nickel system that we've been working on, and talk to you mainly about our electrochemistry work, and I'll finish with some of our water treatment interests. So this is an outline of my talk, just to give you a general idea. I thought I'd start with just a few slides on my group, what we're interested in, our general expertise and focus, and then our sort of 40,000 foot view motivation for our research, and then get into the research part. So I'll talk about how we make our nanoparticles, and then the bulk of my talk will be on the electrochemical catalysis work that we've done. So as I mentioned, we're a materials group. So we make a lot of our catalysts. So we make nanoparticles primarily, and we're starting to make nanowires as well. And as I mentioned, we are interested in the late transition metal, non-precious metals group of materials. So iron and nickel, of course, but we're also interested in cobalt, manganese, and some of the other elements in that group. And so broadly speaking, we have interests and projects in water treatment, energy conversion, and agriculture, and they're certainly interrelated. So for example, we look at things like chlorinated solvents and heavy metals in removing them from water as water contaminants. We're interested in electrochemical energy conversion applications. So I'm showing here water splitting, and we're in particular interested in the oxygen evolution side of water splitting. And then in agriculture, which is a fairly new area for me and the group, we have several projects now in the reduction of dinitrogen to ammonia. So in the US, there's several federal agencies that are now very interested in finding more energy efficient processes that could replace the Haber-Bosch method of making ammonia industrially. And so this, I'm not going to talk about our ammonia work because it's still fairly new for the group. I'm certainly happy to answer questions or talk offline afterwards. It's a really exciting area, but very, very hard. So with that, I thought I'd introduce my group members because they are really the people that do all the experimental work. I get to stand up here and talk about how great it is. So I have five PhD students. So I started with three. So Prashant is doing the oxygen evolution electrochemistry work, and he is starting to make nanowires and makes nanoparticles. Moji actually works a lot with carbon materials. So he does some applied work working with one of our industrial partners to look at groundwater contamination issues, but is also making really fun things like graphene nanoribbons in our lab. And then Shelby was my first PhD student to work on this ammonia project area. So she, again, we have an industrial collaborator, and we have funding from the USDA, and we're trying to reduce dinitrogen to ammonia. So this, in the past 6 months, I added two more PhD students. So Sergio is working on more of a fundamental project with the DOE, looking at ammonia generation. And then David just joined, so he's just getting started on learning our electrochemistry and synthesis methods. Aruni is a postdoc. She just started 2 weeks ago, and she's working on a project with the Army Research Office where we want to try to measure the electron mobility of our some of our composite materials. So very sort of fundamental physics-based project. And then, so at the University of Arkansas, and I know this is a big difference, as I found out from maybe in general in the US, certainly where I am to here, is that I have a number of undergraduate researchers. So we have a very strong undergraduate program. Majority of the students that work with me are in our honors college, and they do honors research, experimental research, and they write a thesis. And so I have about, I think, 12 undergrads right now doing really interesting projects, some independently, some work with graduate students. And so they're really an integral part of the research group, or my research group at Arkansas. So those are my people. They're an amazing group to work with. And I like to introduce them up front to let you know about our group. So the 40,000-foot view. So why are we doing what we're doing? Well, so I think all the time we hear about, you know, fossil fuel dependence, and we need to develop next-generation energy technologies, and we need better water treatment technologies. And when I was sort of finishing my PhD and going into my postdoc, and I was looking at, you know, sort of nanomaterials and this whole sort of entire space, what was really obvious to me is that a lot of these technologies, so a great example is the fuel cell cars that are coming online and will be available to the general public as, you know, as an option to purchase as a car. They use precious metal catalysts. So the catalyst that's in a fuel cell car today is a platinum nanoparticle catalyst. And it's one of the reasons why those cars have a very high price point. And so I am very interested in general in the non-precious metal space to see if we can develop materials that could be competitive with these precious metal catalysts and perhaps bring that price point down to make these sort of next generation or current generation technologies more competitive with the incumbent technologies. And so I always like to put this slide in too, because lots of people do nanoparticles and nanomaterials, and so why nanomaterials? These are some of the reasons why, or some of the things that we think about. So when we're trying to synthesize a material, ideally, we would like to sort of logically design it, or maybe at least be able to control somewhat the properties. So in a bimetallic, particle size is certainly one, but we think a lot about sort of the three-dimensional morphology, so core shell structure versus alloy structure. We think about the lattice structure, the order, actually more importantly, the disorder. So disorder is actually very useful for the reactions that we do. Most of our materials are very disordered. We also think about composition, sort of bimetallic composition, and then also oxygen content, and then other things like shell size and shell thickness. So these are some of the things that we think about, and I think one of the huge advantages of nanomaterials is that sometimes they behave differently, and you can get disorder on the nanoscale, where in a bulk material, it would be a crystalline material. Okay, so how do we make our nanoparticles? So today I'll mainly talk about this morphology right here. So a core shell, so iron core, nickel shell material nominally. And so we use iron and nickel monometallics primarily as comparisons, because the bimetallics work better for our catalysis reactions. And then I'll talk a little bit about the alloys towards the end for the water treatment applications. So we use, in my mind, a very simple and a very scalable technique. So it's aqueous-based solution chemistry. I think what's tricky about it is controlling it and knowing what parameters are important for what you're trying to get. So these are sort of the various knobs that you can turn when you're doing synthesis to try to control what you get. So when I say control, I mean particle size, composition, phase, general structure. And so if we want to make a monometallic or an alloy, it's really just a sort of a single step synthesis process. And for our bimetallics, we do them, for our core shell bimetallics, we do it in two steps where we make the core first and then we put the shell on in a second step. And so this is very scalable. In fact, I think it's a great advantage. We can make, right now we make 10 gram per liter batches and we can make like 100 milliliters. And I have a student who's making, he's designing a continuous flow process. So what we're trying to do in the next year or so is to be able to transition our batch process to a bench scale continuous flow synthesis process so that we can scale, you know, 10x or 100x in terms of the volume that we're making. So this is a real advantage, certainly for our industrial collaborators who need grams and eventually kilograms of material if they would want to scale up what we're doing for a commercial technology. And so a lot of times we want to immobilize our nanoparticles. So we, both for electrochemistry applications and for water treatment, you don't want your nanoparticles just floating around in solution. So you want them immobilized on some sort of a support. And that support is really important. And again, we've taken a fairly simple approach. You could certainly get into more complicated techniques, and I think this is an area where we'd like to work more in to just understand how we combine our nanoparticles with the support impacts their performance. But so we basically, in most cases, make our nanoparticles first and then deposit them onto usually a high surface area or conductive substrate like carbon. Okay, so I'd like to talk the meat of my talk is going to be on electrochemical water splitting, so using our iron nickel bimetallic nanoparticle as a catalyst for water splitting. And so as I mentioned, so fuel cell cars are, I would say, a current technology now, certainly coming online with all of the major car manufacturers. And so these fuel cell cars use hydrogen gas. So the fuel cell replaces the combustion engine in your normal vehicle. And so you need a fuel, and that fuel is hydrogen gas. And so today, the hydrogen gas that goes into cars comes primarily from fossil fuels, so natural gas or coal steam reforming. And if you think about it for a couple of minutes about, you know, what those reactions are, so you get hydrogen, but you also get a lot of CO2. So it's a huge CO2 load, it's a huge source of environmental emissions. And so when we think about the future and the potential of you know, millions of people owning fuel cell cars, we'd like to have an alternative for that hydrogen source. So water splitting is one of the things that people are thinking about for hydrogen. And so we're interested in this guy over here. So you have water as your source and you split it into hydrogen gas and oxygen gas. And so the overall reaction, you get hydrogen as your fuel, but really the problematic side is the oxygen side. So on the anode, so you have the anode here and the cathode here, and the anode, that the catalyst on that anode is typically the slower, it's typically the slower reaction. And so that's really where a lot of people have been focusing efforts to try to develop better catalysts to make the kinetics go faster so that the overall technology is more amenable to commercialization. And so there's two basic setups, both either for fuel cells or for electrolyzers. And I should mention these are low temperature membrane based. So there's other types of fuel cells. I'm talking about the sort of low temperature membrane based ones. With this kind of setup, you have either an acidic environment where you're transporting protons across that membrane between the anode and the cathode, and then you can have an alkaline system where you're transporting hydroxyls. And so this is our focus here because we can stick with non-precious metals. So if you're in an acidic environment, you usually have to have a precious metal. You might be able to do a bimetallic with nickel or something, but you usually have to have a precious metal. And so we have focused on alkaline electrochemistry so that we can stick with completely non-precious metal systems. So, why nickel? So for decades, both in theory and experimentally, people have thought that nickel is perhaps the best catalyst for alkaline electrochemical reactions like water splitting, like oxygen evolution. And so these are just two examples of so-called volcano plots, where typically you're looking at some sort of bond adsorption energy, and you want to be at the peak of the volcano to minimize the energy required to make that reaction happen. And so if you look at these volcano plots, very often nickel or nickel oxide ends up at the peak of that volcano, suggesting that nickel is perhaps the best choice for something like OER. And so people have actually seen this experimentally. And again, I'll say this is, you know, 50, 60 years of work where people have thought nickel was the best. And so there's been a lot of efforts to understand the phases of nickel. So you have alpha and beta nickel hydroxide. And so the beta phase is the more ordered phase, and alpha is the more disordered phase. And so you can actually sort of go between these phases with aging or electrochemistry, and then depending on the potential you're at. And above a certain potential, so around 0.4 volts or so, you go from the hydroxide to the oxyhydroxide. And so there's actually four phases that you can kind of go in between when you're doing electrochemistry with nickel hydroxide. And so what people have thought for a very long time is that, so when you first deposit, let's say you make a nickel hydroxide. So when you first make that hydroxide, people have thought, because they've looked at things like X-ray diffraction data, and they've seen that, okay, at the beginning, we've got the disordered alpha nickel hydroxide phase, and this is the performance. And so for those of you who aren't familiar with electrochemistry, what we're looking at here is applied potential on the x-axis, and on the y-axis is the current density. So how much current are you measuring? And a good catalyst is one that has fairly high current density, so the higher the better. And then you want your curves shifted to the left. So shifted to the left means better kinetics. So high current, shifted to the left. That's what we're looking for. And so what people have seen with nickel hydroxide is that they make it, it's alpha nickel hydroxide according to XRD. And so then they do some electrochemistry and they cycle back and forth. And what happens is what they've called aging. And so you get actually an increase in the performance of this film over time. And so they would do the electrochemistry, and then they take their film out, and they do X-ray diffraction again, and they measured, or they'd characterize it as beta nickel hydroxide. And so what people thought is that you make alpha, you age it, you get beta, and beta is the active phase. So a few years ago, this group out of Berkeley, Alexis Bell's group, did some really interesting experiments where they compared nickel hydroxide, so nickel hydroxide, and they saw this, you know, aging over time. So they started down here and aged and saw an increase in performance. And then they compared to an iron nickel hydroxide, where they intentionally put iron into the nickel hydroxide film. And what they saw was relatively high current density and none of the aging behavior. And so on top of that, then they also plotted, so they actually looked at a range of atomic percent of iron in that nickel hydroxide film. And what they saw here, and so this is current density on the y-axis and atomic iron percent on the x-axis. And so they basically saw this sort of sweet spot up here in terms of iron percent, where the activity was actually equivalent to the activity of the aged nickel electrodes. And so this was kind of confusing to them, because they thought, well, how is it possible that an aged nickel electrode, the beta phase, which definitely doesn't have iron in it, How is it possible that the iron nickel is so as active as this beta phase? And so then came along Shannon Betcher's group from the University of Oregon, who published what I think is just one of the most tremendous papers in the past few years for this entire community, anybody studying nickel hydroxide in alkaline electrochemistry. And so what they did was they looked at electrolyte purity. So they looked at reagent grade KOH, trace select KOH, and then they actually purified their trace select KOH. And they did typical electrochemistry experiments on nickel hydroxide films. And so here you'll see the trace select KOH, reagent grade, and then the purified. And the big difference here is that for trace select and reagent grade, they saw an increase, so that aging behavior where the current goes up, so increase in performance. But for the purified, they actually saw a decrease in activity. So their current actually went down over time. And so they did a really nice set of characterization work as well. And they were actually able to detect iron impurities basically in any film that was not tested in purified KOH. So both of these films ended up with iron impurities in the nickel hydroxide phase, whereas this film did not. And in fact, so basically two things were proven. One, that iron incorporation is actually the reason why nickel hydroxide is so active. And two, it is actually the alpha phase that is more active than the beta phase. And this has just completely transformed this entire field. It's just really a tremendous discovery that iron is actually the reason why these catalysts are so active. And so they also did sort of a comparison where they intentionally doped iron into their nickel hydroxide films and again showed that you know, when you have a certain percentage of iron, you see this nice increase in currents, an increase improvement in the kinetics, and that nickel by itself, nickel hydroxide, is really not that active. And so they also did some modeling and basically have suggested that the phase is similar to the alpha, very disordered phase. It's very similar to the layered double hydroxides phases that have also been studied. And so this was happening as I was getting introduced to electrochemistry. And we were making iron nickel nanoparticles for water treatment. And I met a person who is now a really good collaborator of mine from the Colorado School of Mines. And he said, have you ever thought about using your materials as an electrocatalyst? And so I started doing some reading, and I came across these papers that were coming out at the time, and I thought, that's really interesting. I wonder if we're making that in nanoparticle form. And so we started doing some electrochemistry, and we always use the base purification technique that the Betcher group has basically figured out that you need to do to not have iron impurities coming in from your electrolyte. And we compared this is a core shell, iron nickel core shell nanoparticle material to an iron oxide and a nickel hydroxide nanoparticle controls. And we saw a huge difference in the performance of that catalyst and in the sort of the kinetic performance of the catalyst. So high current and very, very much shifted to the left. And so then what we wanted to do, and this shows you what can be very exciting about nanoparticles, is that we compared both on a surface area, on a per geometric surface area comparison in terms of the current, so milliamps per square centimeter, and then we switched that to be per normalized to our catalyst mass. And here's really where you can see the advantage of nanomaterials. So our catalyst on a per mass basis is much more active than the films that Shannon Betcher and his group study. So this was really exciting for us. And so the question is, okay, do we have a phase that's similar to what the Betcher group was finding in their phases? And eventually, so this is completely unoptimized. We were thinking about it for water treatment, and now, and I'll talk a little bit about it, we're getting into thinking about how can we optimize it for water splitting. So, of course, we wanted to do some characterization to try to understand what, you know, the composition and the morphology of our particles. So we first did some traditional, traditional characterization. So we started with TEM. So this is a set of our TEM image and then our elemental EDX mapping. And so a couple of things I'll point out. One, that we do have an iron core. You can see the nickel shell around here in purple. And then we also have a significant oxygen signal. And that's a good thing, actually, for the reactions that we're trying to do. And so another interesting thing, if you look at the line scan, you'll see here, so the iron core in the middle and then the nickel on the edges. But what's interesting here is that the iron signal actually doesn't go to zero at the shell. It's actually part of the shell. And so if you think about what the Betcher group has shown, this is actually really good for electrocatalysis and for water splitting. So during our synthesis process, we actually have iron migration into the nickel shell. The iron becomes part of that shell phase. And this is really one of the reasons why our catalyst is so active. So we also wanted to understand a little bit the surface composition and the surface structure. And so we did XPS. And so there's a lot of information on this slide, but we're primarily looking, okay, do we have similar phases to what the Betcher group was showing? And so in general, we did sort of, the XPS tells us that we have some mix of hydroxides and perhaps some oxyhydroxides, but sort of inconclusive in terms of you can't really use XPS to say alpha versus beta or, you know, go into the details of that. And so then we also did X-ray diffraction. And so X-ray diffraction doesn't really tell us much. We get very broad peaks. You can calculate the despacing, but despacing is helpful maybe within the same suite of materials. For example, say we were looking at the iron nickel composition and we wanted to see if the despacing was changing. But this doesn't really tell us much because the phases can be very different. And then otherwise, okay, we know we have oxygen there, but we're not really seeing the key oxide peaks that you might see in a normal X-ray diffraction pattern. And so what we ended up doing was going to Argonne National Laboratory to the Advanced Photon Source, which is a high-energy synchrotron source outside of Chicago, Illinois. And so we did several techniques to try to probe the structure of our materials more. And so just to kind of give you a visual of what happened, so this is the synchrotron here. This the circumference of this ring is almost a mile. So it's almost a mile around. And so each one of these little triangles that you see here is a sector. So it's split up into sectors. So what happens is you have an electron source, and you have what are called bending magnets all the way around. So each sector has a set of bending magnets. And so your electrons are basically shot out from the center, and they go around and around and around. And as those electrons go around, you have X-rays coming off tangent to all of the bending magnets. And those X-rays are what we use to do some sort of characterization technique. So you can do diffraction, you can do spectroscopy. There's many, many different techniques. So this is a really sort of, it was a unique opportunity for us and a really powerful way to probe sort of atom level structure of our material. So the first thing that we looked at was high-energy X-ray diffraction. So it's diffraction, but you're using high-energy X-rays. So the key here is that normal powder X-ray diffraction, you're around, well, our XRD is around 8 keV, and so that gives you a wavelength of around 1.54 angstroms. And so with the high-energy X-ray diffraction technique, we're at sector 11 is 105 keV. And so that basically decreases your wavelength by an order of magnitude. And so where that becomes important is over here. So you can, this is just some math that I'm not going to get into. But basically, the wavelength is important. And it comes down to this Q, the wave vector. So your wavelength is right here. So it's used to calculate Q. And so what this does is when you're using your data and transforming it into G space, this Qmax at a synchrotron is much higher. So you can do this for normal X-ray diffraction data, but you won't get as much information as you might from a high energy source. So we did the diffraction experiments, and so what you can get, and this is just an example to show you the power of this technique, is that these are actually only iron only, and even just within our iron only nanoparticles, we can see differences in the amount of oxide, we can see the metal-metal peak, and it's quite powerful for looking at extended lattice structure as well. So for our samples, so again, the iron nickel core shell nanoparticle material, and then the iron only and the nickel only. So this is the same set of data on the left and the right. This is just zoomed in to a smaller radius range. So this is radius in angstroms. And so a couple key points. So high energy X-ray diffraction shows you, gives you an idea of the amount of disorder. So if you had a really, like a bulk crystal, or really crystalline material, you would get peaks all the way out. So what this is basically telling us is that in our material, we lose order, or we have order on the order of 1 nanometer. So if we have crystalline structure, that crystalline structure is on the order of 1 nanometer or less. So this is a very disordered material. The other things that we can tell are primarily in terms of the oxides. So for example, this peak right here, 2.02 angstroms, it's basically between the normal predicted iron oxygen and nickel oxygen bond distance. And so our iron nickel sample actually had a much higher peak, so has more of that oxygen bonding character. And so also, again, on the right side, this peak has been associated with the metal-metal peak in the alpha nickel hydroxide and the more disordered hydroxides. So again, kind of indicating to us that we may have a phase that's similar to what the Vetter group was showing in their thin films. So then we also did what's known as X-ray absorption spectroscopy. So this technique is extremely powerful because it's element specific. So the disadvantage of diffraction is that we have a bimetallic, and so we're probing both iron atoms and then nickel atoms. And in absorption spectroscopy, you actually probe one element at a time. So you set the absorption energy, and you look at iron, and then you go back and look at nickel for the same sample. And so what you can tell are things like the first coordination sphere, essentially who is, if you're looking at a certain element, who is the neighbor of that element? And then you can get things like atom pair distances and different atom pair bonding events. And so we used X-ray absorption spectroscopy, and this is just for the bimetallic nanoparticles. And so this is the iron edge and the nickel absorption edge. And so really the key takeaways, I think, for us were on the nickel side. So what I don't show here is that you run your sample and then you run a whole host of standards. So any phase that we thought might be there, we ran a standard for it. So you run, you know, one experimental sample and then like 20, you know, comparison samples of different phases that you might get. And you use all of that data to model your absorption edge and to predict what are the primary phases of your experimental material. And so what showed up primarily is the alpha nickel hydroxide phase. And so really all of this data combined, and you know, I think it's difficult with nanomaterials because they are heterogeneous, they are more difficult to characterize than a thin film. But I would say sort of the overall story that we think we have is that we are making a fairly disordered material that we are likely, you know, working with a similar phase as what the Vetter group has shown in their films, and we can make it in a nanoparticle form, so we get really high mass activities. And so this was really a huge effort, a multi-year effort, and we just published this work in a paper that came out just last month, actually, in ACS Catalysis. So This was really a big effort to try to understand what we have. And so from here, I think we can do a lot of interesting things. So one of the things that Prashant's working on now is trying to get into different morphologies and different compositions. So what happens when we change the iron-nickel ratio? What happens when we make an alloy versus a core shell? Things I'm sure that many of you can think of, like what happens when we control the thickness of the shell? So these are all things that we'd like to look at. And it's pretty incredible how you can tune the synthesis parameters and get really significant changes in the performance of, so sort of the kinetic behavior and then certainly the behavior of the current output. So one of the other things that we've looked at and that people have sort of asked us about is, okay, so you can do OER, can these particles do anything else with electrochemistry? And so one of the things that was sort of a low-hanging fruit that we have done a little bit of work in is thinking about, can we do fuel oxidation? So can we use these particles as an electrocatalyst for an alkaline fuel cell that might be using alternative fuels? So methanol is an easy place to start in terms of a target test compound. And the theory sort of predicts that the transition metals, the non-precious metal transition metals, may be good in terms of supporting methanol oxidation. The issue with nickel is that nickel by itself tends to hold on to oxygen too strongly. And so the kinetics of methanol oxidation tend to be very slow. And so what people have looked at is combining nickel with other metals. And we thought, what maybe having a bimetallic with iron might work. And so we've done a little bit of testing basically to show that we do get an increase in current density over our two controls. What's interesting is that for methanol oxidation, actually nickel by itself doesn't do too badly, but certainly our iron nanoparticles actually, iron nickel nanoparticles turn out to be much better, and certainly better than this light green is actually the control, and then this one is with methanol, so showing you the difference here. And so this has sort of gotten us into thinking about how to tune the synthesis methods that we use to tune our particles for one reaction over the other. So one thing to notice here is that when you're oxidizing fuel, you're in the same potential range as water splitting. So if you want to oxidize a fuel like methanol, you want to be sort of in this region, because as you get further up in potential, most of your current's coming from water splitting, which doesn't really help so much with your fuel oxidation. And so what we would like to do is to be able to tune our catalyst to say, go more towards methanol oxidation versus water splitting and vice versa. And so what we've looked at a little bit is understanding what of our various synthesis parameters are really keys to tuning our materials for different reactions. And so what we've seen is that we can actually tune our nanoparticles. And this is an example of water electrolysis on the left compared to methanol oxidation on the right. And as you see, this is just one parameter. So how fast we add in our reducing agent actually can make a big difference in terms of the performance of these particles. So for water electrolysis, so this is slow, medium, and fast. And offhand, I forget, my student did actually stick to a certain milliliters per minute flow rate. I don't remember them offhand, but slow, medium, and fast. So medium turned out to be the best for water electrolysis, whereas slow turned out to be the best for methanol oxidation. So this suggests that with the tuning of, you know, sort of simple tuning of our parameters, we can actually target one reaction over the other within the same material space. And so, of course, what we'd like to do is also understand what we're getting. And so we've just really started to characterize these different materials. This is just one example. Again, so this is another high-energy X-ray diffraction data set looking at that slow, medium, fast of the reducing agent addition speed. And so you'll see some key differences, mainly in the sort of oxide shoulder and in the order of the material. So this fast rate was much more ordered, or produced a much more ordered material than the slow and the medium. And then we also see differences in our metal-metal peak, suggesting variation in the metal-metal bond distance. And so overall, we see that the fast addition is more ordered with less oxide, whereas the slow has less oxide but is more disordered, and that the medium and the slow, the medium has more oxide and they're more disordered. So the order, the amount of oxide, the amount of metallic character, these are things that we're actually shifting just by simply changing the rate of addition of one of our reactants. So understanding this could be a really powerful way to be able to tune our material. So finally, one thing that I'm really interested in, and we've done some preliminary work and just submitted a proposal to hopefully do some more, is so everything I've shown you so far has been dry ex situ characterization, except then we take our material and we put it in a liquid electrolyte and we test it as a catalyst under applied potential. And we do that, but we know that the catalyst material can change in its operating environment. So what I really want to do, and we've, like I said, we've done a little bit of it, but what I think is really important for the entire field and for my group is to be able to do more in situ operando characterization. So taking that catalyst material, putting it in its operating environment, and being able to understand the structure of that catalyst in the operating environment. So we've done a little bit with X-ray absorption spectroscopy, so I'll just show you a few slides to just show you that this is a really big deal, and we need to understand this to, as a field, to really push these materials forward and know what we should design in the first place. So this is the iron edge. This is actually X-ray absorption spectroscopy data, the exaphs region. So you're looking at radial distance from that element. So this is iron specific, so you can imagine all of the iron atoms in our catalyst, we're looking at radial distance from that those iron atoms. And so I'm just showing you here in red is our iron nickel core shell nanoparticle, and then in blue is just an iron foil, so it's just a control piece of foil. So this is ex situ, dry. So the metal-metal peaks show up, iron nickel, and iron-iron sort of overlap here, and it matches up fairly well with the foil. So when you put it into base and you apply a potential, you get a completely different story. So the purple is the ex situ data that I just showed in the slide before of our iron-nickel nanoparticle. The green is when we add NaOH, so one molar NaOH shifts this peak. And then the blue and the red, so the blue is with an applied potential in the OER range, and then the red is with the methanol added in. And so two really interesting things, we get a huge shift in our spectra suggesting that we shift from primarily a metal-metal behavior to a metal-oxygen behavior. And the methanol doesn't do too much. So the methanol by itself doesn't seem to change the surface structure, the structure of the catalyst too much. It's really that applied potential that makes the big difference. So what's also interesting, so this is the nickel edge. Again, our iron nickel nanoparticles in blue, and then a nickel hydroxide control material in red, ex situ. So again, in situ, when we apply a potential and add in methanol, we go from the green, which is ex situ, to the red and the blue. And we, again, see shifts. In this case, we see a similar behavior, but just generally shifted to the left, which suggests smaller atom pair distances. So this is what I am hoping to do more of in our group. And it turns out, and I tend to be someone who kind of jumps in sometimes to try things, I learned that these techniques are extremely difficult. There's a lot to learn. And the in situ experiments are very, very difficult to get right and to be confident that you trust your data and can do it repeatedly. So I'm actually working now with two different collaborators, one at Argonne and then one who is both in Berkeley and Karlsruhe at the synchrotron facilities there to try to collaborate and push this effort of our group forward. So I'll just finish up with a little bit about how this all translates back to water treatment. So water treatment I mean, I love electrochemistry, but water treatment is really sort of a personal passion of mine. And when I started my postdoc, I was really interested in the application of iron nanoparticles to water. And so at that time, there was a lot of literature coming out in the water community showing, okay, we can degrade pesticides and herbicides and industrial chemicals, and we can remove heavy metals. And everyone was really excited about this because if you think about water, you never have just one contaminant. So if you want to develop a new technology, it needs to be a broad spectrum treatment technology. It needs to address a whole host of contaminants. And it needs to be able to do that in a mixture. And so I was, and I think people in general were really excited about iron because that's what iron does. It can really deal with, for example, reductive degradation. It can remove chlorines off of trichloroethylene. And at the same time, it can actually participate in oxidative reactions and degrade things like pesticides and other, you know, pharmaceutical chemicals. And then it can also actually adsorb things like arsenic and change the oxidation state and convert it to the, you know, a less toxic form. So really, really interesting material in terms of water treatment. But my PhD advisor always said there is no free lunch. So iron is great because it's really reactive, and iron is a challenge because it's really reactive. So when you think again about water treatment and using this in a real scenario, nanoparticles, iron nanoparticles can, you can use all of the reactivity within hours. And a water treatment material needs to last for weeks or months, especially paired with, you know, other, if you start to think about other processes used in water treatment, those materials last for a long time. So one of the biggest challenges with iron nanoparticles in water is extending the lifetime and being able to use it at least for weeks, if not longer. And so there are two main strategies that we've thought about. One is combining iron with another metal, and this is actually how I got into iron nickel nanoparticles. So again, you know, when I was first thinking about this, people were looking at palladium, and I just thought, okay, that's interesting, but it's never going to happen. Palladium's way too expensive. So I really, you know, made the choice to stick with non-precious metals and was looking at iron nickel. And then people have also looked at the support, the role of support. So for example, putting nanoparticles onto a carbon structure. So this is just one example where people have shown that when you put iron nanoparticles, so ZVI is zero valent iron. So when you put iron nanoparticles onto conductive or carbon support, you get an increase in removal of contaminants. So what's really interesting, has really kind of caught my attention recently, is people have shown that if you put iron nanoparticles onto conductive carbon, so for example, graphite or graphene oxide, you actually get enhanced reactivity beyond what you see with a non-conductive support like a resin or an activated carbon. And so these is just a couple of papers, but they've sort of indirectly shown and suggested that there's some sort of electron transfer going on between the nanoparticles on the surface and that conductive support. And it makes sense because the conductive electrons are moving more easily. So one of the things that we've been interested in is looking at our bimetallics and then conductive supports and seeing if we see some of the similar behavior. So for this project, we've been looking at alloy and core shell nanoparticles. So again, the iron nickel oxide hydroxide combination. And we first started off just looking at how does composition and morphology affect the removal of a textile dye, orange G. And so here we're looking at a data set for alloy and core shell nanoparticles in different molar ratios of nickel to iron. So 1:1 is 1 mole of nickel to 1 mole of iron. And I would say the two big takeaways for us in this data set were, one, that the alloys performed just as well, if not sometimes better, than the core shells. And this is one of those times where you have this preconceived notion of what was going to happen, and that's not what happened. So I found that really interesting. And then the fact that the lower nickel to iron ratios actually performed just as well, if not better, in some cases, than the higher nickel to iron ratios. And the reason this is important is that One, nickel is actually more expensive than iron. So if you start to think about cost, you would like to limit nickel. And two, nickel's a regulated compound. So the EPA, the US EPA regulates nickel in all effluent and all drinking water at relatively low concentrations. So we would like to minimize the amount of nickel that we use for water treatment technology. So we were really excited that actually our lower nickel content particles worked really well. And so what we've started looking at is this idea of does the conductivity of the substrate matter for these nanoparticles and the removal of a target contaminant? And so we kind of stumbled onto this a little bit by chance. So Ketchin carbon is a conductive carbon that's used in electrochemistry. And so I had these two students and I said, just go into the lab and test all the carbons that we have. Just pick out a couple. They happened to pick out an activated carbon that's used in water treatment all the time. And they happened to pick out the Ketchin carbon. And so they actually tested a non-conductive activated carbon and a fairly conductive carbon that's typically used in electrochemistry, not in water treatment. And so what's really interesting is that when they got the molar ratio of nanoparticles to carbon right, they saw a significant increase in the performance of the composite when they used conductive carbon versus when they used just the activated carbon. And so this has really sort of opened up a new area for us. We're starting to look at other conductive carbons. We're looking at some graphene and graphene oxides to do some more controlled sort of fundamental work to understand, to really try to figure out, is the conductivity important? Or is it really more about the surface structure and the pore size and the adsorption capability? Because those are all mechanisms, and they're in this system, they're all happening at the same time. So what our sort of work right now is to try to pick apart those mechanisms to be able to say, yes, conductivity is important, and we should be thinking about that when we make composites like this for water treatment. And so I'll just finish on another interesting piece that is sort of a marriage of electrochemistry materials and water. As with my collaborator, that same collaborator from the School of Mines. So he functionalizes conductive carbons with these heteropolyacids that are used in electrochemistry. They're used in electrophotocatalysis. And we thought, okay, well, maybe they'd be useful for water treatment if the conductive carbons are useful. And this is just to show you a little bit that this is a really interesting area too, as well, because we get different removals of the target water contaminant based on the chemical composition of the heteropolyacid with our nanoparticles. So this is sort of kind of a whole new area for us that we're going into, and really, I think, a really exciting overlap of the electrochemistry side and the materials that you use and the water chemistry side. So with that, I'd like to just acknowledge some of my key collaborators and certainly our funding sources, and I'll take any questions.
Lauren, is this one turned on? Doesn't matter. Okay, Lauren, with your experiments where you measured the change in concentration of the dye with the different nanoparticles, how do you distinguish between the difference in concentration that's occurring from reaction of the dye versus just pure adsorption of the dye on the particles that's taking it out of solution?
So that's a great question. So for our initial study, we also did mass spec on the super. So the way that we do this experiment is in batch right now. And so it's a batch reactor. And so my students will take out, you know, aliquots at the time. And then they centrifuge to take the particles out. And they'll test that supernatant. And so for dye removal, we just use UV vis. So we also took those supernatants and the particles, and we tried to do an extraction on the particles, and then we also tested the supernatants using mass spec. And I would say that we don't know the full story in terms of, I couldn't tell you the mechanism, the entire reaction mechanism. But we see degradation of the orange D compound for sure in the supernatant. We did not and this probably has to do with our extraction process. I think it's quite difficult to do it well and convince yourself that you're seeing the whole story, but I was not convinced that our mass spec data from trying to desorb whatever was on the surface, to me that wasn't completely conclusive. We see degradation products there too. We see some orange G, but we not that much really. So we do think that it's a combo mechanism, adsorption and degradation, but that we are at least partially degrading the compound.
Any other questions? Jeff.
Lauren, I greatly enjoyed your talk.
Thanks.
Could you tell us how you normalize your current densities when you've got nanoparticles so
yeah.
that you're making a fair comparison? So in other words, if you take the real area, whatever that is,
right.
into account, do the nanoparticles have any additional benefits?
I would say that I don't have a complete answer for you yet. All of the data that you saw that were normalized to an area, that is geometric surface area. So that is just the geometric surface area of our test electrode. The mass normalization is the mass that we know is on there. That does not tell you anything about what is the active or accessible surface area of the nanoparticles. We do use very low loadings. So our loadings are around 30 micrograms per square centimeter, which is fairly low. But that doesn't mean that we don't have, you know, agglomeration or some stacking. And we just... It's actually being installed, I think, next week. We purchased a BET analyzer, so we're going to be able to do nitrogen, argon, and CO2 adsorption, desorption. So we'll be able to start to get at your question of what is the available surface area. And then we also bought, it's a flow-based, it's similar to sort of the gas phase analyzers, but it's flow-based, and you can do reactive gases, and you can do gas mixtures, and you can do vapor. So we're hoping to be able to separate out available surface area versus reactive surface area, which is always a I don't know. I think it's an interesting discussion in the catalyst community of what is your active surface area? Have you measured it appropriately? So I've really stuck to geometric surface area, and that's the mass that we know is there, and that's the best we can do right now. And hopefully we can add in, you know, available surface area data and look at what happens to our data when we normalize that way, and what does it tell us in terms of, is it just a mass transport limitation that we're overcoming, or do we have really active sites that the films don't necessarily have? So it's a great question.
Do you have any high-resolution TEM data to show that at the boundary of the calcium nickel iron particles, so you can look at how the atoms they?
Not that high resolution. No.
The high resolution. Is that possible?
So the short answer is no. The long answer is the TEM that I did show took quite a while to get. These are tricky, really tricky to try to do high-res TM on because we use organic ligands and because they're oxides that we don't want to disrupt. So it's very difficult to clean them and not change what you have. So we ended up doing really short, like 10-second argon plasma clean, and we're able to get those images. But the TM guy that was working with us said, you know, any longer, and you know, he started to see degradation, and wasn't confident that he felt like the samples were being affected. So I haven't tried to push that to try to get sort of atom scale resolution.
Any other questions? Let me ask one question, and we could probably. And here. So I've just looked at your concentration of nanoparticles for water purification,
mm-hmm.
and it's 0.1 grams per liter.
Mm-hmm.
as a nanoparticle, let's say somebody's drinking a liter of water, would it shut down the kidneys of a concentration of 0.1 grams per liter?
So I would say that concentration is never going to be in your water in the first place.
Right.
Highly doubtful, though, because you would really get agglomeration. I mean, yeah, we make, and plus our particles are pretty big, you know. And one of the reasons why I haven't tried to go too small, because you get into questions like this, and I can say our particles are 150 nanometers. Highly unlikely that they would cross, say, the blood-brain barrier. But on top of that, we know they agglomerate. We fight it all the time. So in a natural system where you have natural organic matter and you have other things happening, they would be agglomerates, I think. Yeah.
Do we have any other questions? So again, let's... sorry.
It might be because I don't work with material a lot, but one of the things that you mentioned is the aging of your sodium borohydride will actually affect your reaction if you look at the synthesis conditions. I was just wondering what was meant by that.
Aging.
It was like age of the reagent.
Oh, so sodium borohydride is hygroscopic. So you have to be pretty careful to keep it dry, and we've learned that aged... sodium borohydride, even if you account for, say, the mass change and you have the right ratio of reactant to metal precursor, we still get weird results sometimes. So we're very careful to either use relatively fresh reagent and we keep it dry. Yeah.
Do you see any boron in your deposits?
The honest answer is we haven't looked very closely. It's something that I've been asked once or twice, and it's likely that we do get some boron incorporation. In fact, if you look at some of the original papers where people were looking at borohydride reduction reactions with metals like iron, they did show boron incorporation. So it's likely that we have some.
All right, so let us all thank Professor Greenlee for... a wonderful talk.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. It was a great pleasure.